be with you.
And also with you.
Good morning and welcome to everyone. A couple of announcements before we begin. First of all, as you can tell, we've got a guest here with us this morning. We have a baptism, and this is Professor John Pless. Professor Pless is the one of the godparents, and so Jacob asked if he would be interested in preaching, and he is sort of be preaching the sermon this morning. So everybody take notes, and I'll be testing you next week on that. So, in view of the baptism, though, the Corzines have also invited everyone to join them to celebrate after the service. We've got the usual food this week, and so invite you to come join us for that. And today is also their last Sunday. They're moving to St. Louis, so it's kind of a goodbye to them. So we'll certainly miss having them in our midst as well. In addition to that, other announcements. Terry, the church secretary, will be on vacation this coming week. I'll be around for the most part, so if you need anything, please feel free to call in the usual hours or not, or leave a message or call me on my cell phone. And then next week there will be script collection, so please make sure to bring those orders. Then also mark your calendars. The church picnic will be August 26th, so we've got the sign-up sheets for that, and that'll be in the afternoon as usual, so please make sure to sign up. And then last, we have 3 weeks open for flower dedications in this month. So if you have an interest in getting the flowers, please make sure to do that as well. So other than that, our opening hymn this morning is, in view of the baptism, hymn 592, Dearest Jesus, We Are Here, hymn 592. And then we will have the baptism immediately following that hymn.
Thank you.
Lord says in the last chapter of Matthew, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. In the last chapter of Mark, our Lord promises, whoever is baptized, believes and is baptized will be saved. And the Apostle Peter has written, baptism now saves you. The Word of God also teaches that we are all conceived and born sinful, and are under the power of the devil until Christ claims us as his own. Therefore, depart, you unclean spirit, and make room for the Holy Spirit, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Will you receive the sign of the Holy Cross both upon your forehead and upon your heart? Mark you as one redeemed by Christ the crucified.
Amen.
Let us pray. Almighty and eternal God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we pray on behalf of your servant William, who asks for the gift of your baptism and desires your eternal grace through spiritual rebirth, Receive him, Lord, according to your promise. Ask, and it will be given to you. Seek, and you will find. Knock, and it will be opened to you. Now give your blessing to him who asks, and open the door to him who knocks, so that he may obtain the eternal blessing of his heavenly bath and receive the promised kingdom that you give, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Almighty and eternal God, according to your strict judgment, you condemn the unbelieving world in the flood, yet according to your great mercy, you preserve believing Noah and his family, eight souls in all. You drown the hard-hearted Pharaoh and all his host in the Red Sea, yet led your people Israel through the water on dry ground, foreshadowing this washing of your holy baptism. Through the baptism in the Jordan of your beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, you sanctified and instituted all waters to be a blessed flood and lavish washing away of sin. We pray that you would behold William according to your boundless mercy, and bless him with true faith by the Holy Spirit, that through this saving flood all sin in him, which has been inherited from Adam, and which he himself has committed since, will be drowned and die. Grant that he be kept safe and secure in the holy ark of the Christian Church, being separated from the multitude of unbelievers, and serving your name at all times with a fervent spirit and a joyful hope, so that with all believers in your promise, he will be declared worthy of eternal life, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Hear the Holy Gospel according to St. Mark. They brought young children to Jesus that he might touch them, but the disciples rebuked those who brought them. But when Jesus saw it, he was greatly displeased and said to them, "Let the little children come to me, and do not forbid them, for of such is the kingdom of God. Assuredly, I say to you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will by no means enter it." And he took them up in his arms and put his hands on them and blessed them.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
The Lord preserve your coming in and your going out from this time forth, and even forevermore.
Amen.
I invite the congregation to respond on behalf of God. William, do you renounce the devil?
Yes, I renounce him.
Do you renounce all his works?
Yes, I renounce him.
Do you renounce all his ways?
Yes, I renounce him.
Do you believe in God the Father, Almighty Maker of heaven and earth?
Yes, I believe.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell, and the third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead.
Yes, I believe.
Do you believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting?
Yes, I believe.
William, you desire to be baptized?
Yes, I do.
sins, strengthen you with his grace to life everlasting.
Amen.
Peace be with you. Having been reminded of our God's grace given to us in baptism, we continue with the service of the word. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good.
For his steadfast love endures forever.
Give thanks to the God of gods.
For his steadfast love endures forever.
Give thanks to the Lord of lords.
For his steadfast love endures forever.
To him alone, who alone does great wonders.
For his steadfast love endures forever.
To him who by understanding made the heavens.
For his steadfast love endures forever.
To him who spread out the earth above the waters.
For his steadfast love endures forever.
To him who made the great lights.
For his steadfast love endures forever.
The sun to rule over the day.
For his steadfast love endures forever.
The moon and stars to rule over the night.
For his steadfast love endures forever.
It is he who remembered us in our low estate.
For his steadfast love endures forever.
And rescued us from our foes.
For his steadfast love endures forever.
He who gives food to all flesh.
For his steadfast love endures forever.
Give thanks to the God of heaven.
For his steadfast love endures forever.
The Old Testament reading for this the 10th Sunday after Pentecost is from the 55th chapter of the book of the prophet Isaiah. Come, everyone who thirsts, come to the waters, and he who has no money, come, buy and eat. Come, buy wine and milk without money and without price. Why do you spend your money for that which is not bread, and your labor for that which does not satisfy? Listen diligently to me and eat what is good, and delight yourselves in rich food. Incline your ear and come to me. Hear that your soul may live, and I will make with you an everlasting covenant, my steadfast, sure love for David. Behold, I made him a witness to the peoples, a leader and commander for the peoples. Behold, you shall call a nation that you do not know, and a nation that did not know you shall run to you, because of the Lord your God and of the Holy One of Israel. For he has glorified you. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle lesson is from Paul's letter to the Romans, the 9th chapter. I am speaking the truth in Christ, I am not lying. My conscience bears me witness in the Holy Spirit that I have great sorrow and unceasing anguish in my heart. For I could wish that I myself were accursed and cut off from Christ for the sake of my brothers, my kinsmen according to the flesh. They are Israelites, and to them belong the adoption, the glory, the covenants, the giving of the law, the worship, and the promises. To them belong the patriarchs, and from their race, according to the flesh, is the Christ, who is God over all, blessed forever. Amen. But it is not as though the word of God has failed, for not all who are descended from Israel belong to Israel, and not all are children of Abraham, because they are his offspring. But through Isaac shall your offspring be named. This means that it is not the children of the flesh who are the children of God, but the children of the promise are counted as offspring. For this is what the promise said: about this time next year I will return, and Sarah shall have a son. And not only so, but also when Rebekah had conceived children by one man, our forefather Isaac, though they were not yet born and had done nothing either good or bad, in order that God's purpose of election might continue, not because of works, but because of his call, she was told, the older will serve the younger. As it is written, Jacob I love, but Esau I hate. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please rise for our Lord's words. Now when Jesus heard about the death of John, he withdrew from there in a boat to a desolate place by himself. But when the crowds heard it, they followed him on foot from the towns. When he went ashore, he saw a great crowd, and he had compassion on them and healed their sick. Now when it was evening, the disciples came to him and said, this is a desolate place, and the day is now over. Send the crowds away to go into the villages and buy food for themselves. But Jesus said, they need not go away. You give them something to eat. They said to him, we have only 5 loaves here and 2 fish. And he said, bring them here to me. Then he ordered the crowds to sit down on the grass, and taking the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, he looked up to heaven and said a blessing. Then he broke the loaves and gave them to the disciples, and the disciples gave them to the crowds, and they all ate and were satisfied. And they took up 12 baskets full of the broken pieces left over. And those who ate were about 5,000 men, besides women and children. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
I believe in one God, Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation
Peace be unto you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. The news of John the Baptist's bloody beheading by Herod at request of his daughter at her gruesome birthday party reached Jesus. Mark tells us that then Jesus retreated by way of a boat to a lonely place, isolated from these bizarre festivities. But it didn't take long for the crowds who had followed Jesus, listening to his teaching as they trailed him from town to town, to seek him out. So those who cling to Jesus' words follow him even into the wilderness. The disciples, ever pragmatic, were worried about logistics. The day is far spent, and there's no source of food inside. No five-star restaurants, no mom-and-pop diners, no fast food joints, no caterer who would venture out into that isolated venue to serve these followers of Jesus. Just barren, empty countryside. The disciples have a solution. Send them away. Let them go back to the villages. But that would not help. And you can imagine how the disciples must have reacted, at least in their mind, when Jesus says, you take care of it. You give them something to eat. He must be joking. Taking stock of their resources, the disciples can only bring forward a couple of fish and 5 loaves of bread. That's only crumbs compared to 5,000 hungry men, plus, Mark tells us, the women and the children. Jesus takes that meager bread and the fish and he blesses it. He gives thanks to God for this gift of daily bread. And then he gives it to the disciples to distribute, and the multitudes eat and they are satisfied. There are even 12 baskets of leftovers. What would our Lord have us learn from this event? The account of the feeding of the 5,000 echoes the Lord feeding his people with manna in the wilderness. Just as Yahweh had compassion on the grumbling Israelites that he had rescued from Pharaoh's yoke of slavery, filling their bellies in the desert, so now Yahweh in the flesh does not leave the multitude without provision in this wilderness. He opens his hand and he satisfies the desire of every living creature. That's what we learn from the Psalms. And now that Lord, who was confessed as the giver of every good thing in the Psalms, is here in the flesh, doing what only God can do. And so he gives them food without price. He sustains them in their neediness. There is a striking difference, though, between Exodus and the event that we've heard about from the gospel. When God provided manna to the children of Israel in Sinai's desert, Moses strictly charged them to gather up only enough of this strange heavenly bread for the day. Leftovers were forbidden, with the warning that if they tried to save any of it, grow rancid, be inedible, spoiled. But where Jesus is the host, there is always more than enough. So much so that the 12 baskets of fragments are collected after the crowd enjoyed their fish dinner. Jesus is not a new Moses. John tells us in his gospel that the law came through Moses, but grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. You see, Moses and his law are always measuring, quantifying, and qualifying things. But Jesus, with his gospel, is the giver of every good and perfect gift. And with him, there is always more. Grace upon grace. Blessing upon blessing. With Jesus, there is more. His favor. His steadfast love is inexhaustible. His steadfast mercy and his goodness are always more than we can measure, much less comprehend. In 1 Corinthians 4, the Apostle Paul poses the rhetorical question, what did you have that you did not receive? And he anticipates the answer, absolutely nothing. You see, God is the giver and the donor of every good gift. We give God nothing but our sin and death. We give God nothing but our hunger and our neediness. But he is the recipient, who gives not only bread to satisfy the stomach, but he gives himself as that living bread from heaven, the very bread of life, that sustains these earthly bodies to the resurrection, to death, to eternal life. You see, every gift of body and soul are from him. Luther puts it like this in his exposition of the third article of the Creed in the Large Catechism, where he writes, for in all three articles, God himself has revealed and opened for us the most profound depths of his fatherly heart and his pure, unutterable love. For this very purpose, he created us, so that he might redeem us and make us holy, and moreover, having granted and bestowed upon us everything in heaven and on earth, he has given his Son and his Holy Spirit, through whom he brings us to himself. The gifts of each article of the Creed are given us through Jesus Christ our Lord. He is the Word by whom all things were made, and all creation holds together and is sustained in him. He is the one who is both the Son of the Father and the Son of Mary, who has purchased and won us by his own blood, that we might be his own and live under him in his kingdom in everlasting righteousness, blessedness, innocence. He is the one who gives us his Holy Spirit, who calls us to faith by this preaching of the gospel that you are hearing right at this very moment. And we witness the bounty of his giving this morning in this divine service, as the Father who knit William together in the womb and gave him to Jacob and Tia as their son, has now put his name on William, claiming him as his beloved child and heir for time and for eternity. The inheritance given to William in the water and the word is the same inheritance that was given to you in your baptism into Christ. And as our confessions remind us, God is exceedingly rich and generous in doling out his gifts, not only in baptism, but in the absolution that declares and delivers to you the forgiveness of all your sins for Jesus' sake, in the preaching of the gospel, in the body and the blood of Christ, given under bread and wine for us Christians to eat and to drink, and in the words of mutual consolation and encouragement placed on the lips of fellow Christians. You can't outgive God, and he is always giving. And with him, there is always more. So that when this life is done and this mortal body is put to the grave, there is still more. And on that last day, according to the promise, he will raise you and give to you and all believers eternal life. Always more. To know Jesus Christ is to know God the Father. For in him the fatherly heart of God is revealed. And where the fatherly heart of God is revealed in Jesus, then the ordinary things of creation, like bread and fish, are seen in a new light. Luther put it like this. Now, if I believe in God's Son and bear him in mind, that he became man, all creatures will appear 100 times more beautiful to me than before. Then I will properly appreciate the sun, the moon, the stars, the trees, apples and pears, as I reflect that he is Lord over all, and he is the center of all things. In light of his word, a few scaly fish and 5 loaves of stale bread are seen in a new light. They are seen for what they are. Precious gifts from the Lord, who is not stingy in giving good gifts without any merit or worthiness on our part. The Lord who feeds weary followers in the wilderness is indeed the center of all things. Crucified for your sins, and raised again for your justification, he now lives as your brother. With him as the fountain and source of every blessing, there's no need for puny entitlements, pointless anxieties, or corrosive greed. He gives. Faith can only receive. Faith receives his gifts, not only for the soul, but for body and soul together. Faith receives with thanksgiving. As the Apostle Paul says in 1 Timothy 4, for everything created by God is good, and nothing is to be rejected if it is received with thanksgiving, for then it is consecrated by the word of God. Prayer. Jesus and his gifts. He is the giver. You are the receiver. Trust in his words. And receiving his gifts, give thanks to him, for he lives and reigns with his Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus, the life of the lost.
Almighty God, Heavenly Father, you are gracious beyond measure. In the wilderness, your Son healed the sick, miraculously fed over 5,000 and satisfied them. We give you thanks for all that you provide to support our bodies and lives. Lead us always to look to you as a loving Father who knows what we need and supplies it. Make us content with what you give, that we may not covet what others have or turn elsewhere for what only comes from your hand. Lord, in your mercy. Gracious Lord, you have made us children of the promise on account of your Son. Let your promises continue to go to the ends of the earth. Incline the ears of all who listen, that their souls may live. Bless William in those promises and the joy of your work in baptism. By your grace, also make pastors faithful witnesses of the Holy One of Israel, whom you glorify by resurrection and Israel. Lord, in your mercy. Lord God, we pray for this land, that we may have devout and faithful rulers, good government, good weather, faithful neighbors, and the like. Lord, in your mercy. Blessed Lord, you give every good gift. Grant that we would always appreciate what you give. In your mercy, bless also those celebrating your gifts of birthdays, anniversaries, and other joyous occasions, especially Mary Rosaro, Annabelle Enright, Yannick Brown, Lynn Johnson, Rachel and John Pisek, and Jessica and Matthew. Lord, in your mercy. God, comfort as your Son healed the sick, so also heal those who are in need of your care in body and soul in our midst. Especially those listed in our bulletin: Leslie, Therese, Walt, Bob, Mary Beth, Ann, Nancy and Kent, Jerry, the Torzine family, Blake, John, Sarah, Richard, John, Cash, Christine, Ken, Cassie, Emily, Joanne, Doris, Laurel, the Cooey family, Chris, Eleanor, the Loggett family, Allison, John, Bruce, Rod, Ellen, Lisa, Tom, Kathy, Benjamin, Frank, Dorothy, Rachel, Levi, Jamie, Leah, Jurgen, Caitlin, Leonard, Bill, Kurt, Rose, Adam, Kimmy, Sarah, Sharon, Don and Gail, Judy and Kurt, Vanessa, Noah, Katie, Brian and Janelle, Amelia, Jennifer, Jim, Pat, and Nancy. If it be your will, restore all those who need of it to health and peace, or give them strength to accept their affliction. Grant them all also hope for the day when the corruptible will put on incorruption. By your grace, grant also food to the hungry, shelter for the homeless, trusting your promise of forgiveness, that we may be strengthened in faith toward you and in love for one and toward others. Lord, in your mercy. Into your hands, Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with
my spirit. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up unto the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is meet and right so to do.
It is truly meet, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who out of his love for his fallen creation humbled himself by taking on the form of a servant, becoming obedient unto death, even death upon the cross. Risen from the dead, he has freed us from eternal death and given us life everlasting. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, Christ, strengthen and preserve your body and soul, and once you're saved in faith and life everlasting.